All right, so this is the beginning of a course on abstract algebra. In particular, it's an undergraduate course on abstract algebra, and we're going to be taking what's called a rings first approach to this course. So the only assumptions we're going to make is that you're familiar with how to write a proof. So you've seen direct proofs, proofs by contradiction, and induction proofs. There are two topics typically covered in an undergraduate one semester abstract algebra class, and these are groups and rings. And typically, groups are done first because they're in some sense simpler, and rings are done second. But pedagogically, there are some advantages to talking about rings first. So rings tend to be a little bit better behaved in the sense that we're more familiar with the types of operations that are used in rings. So what exactly are we talking about here? What is this course going to cover? The first thing we're going to do is we're going to talk about arithmetic in Z. So we'll review some basic number theory. We'll talk about the division algorithm. We'll talk about divisibility, greatest common divisors, and unique factorization, namely that any integer that's not zero or plus or minus one can be written as a product of primes in some unique way. So these are things you may or may not have seen in a proof writing class. And if you haven't seen them, that's okay. We'll review all their proofs and we'll go through all of this material. But we will assume that you're familiar with things like addition, multiplication, subtraction, and just some basics about the integers. After we're done with this basic number theory, we'll talk about congruence modulo n in Z, and we'll talk about modular arithmetic. After that, we'll approach rings. And so you might ask, well, what is a ring? A ring is a set that has two binary operations defined on it. What do I mean by binary operations? I mean, it has two operations where I take two elements, combine them, and create a new element. So our prototype for a ring is going to be the integers, for example. The integers, we have two natural operations. We can add integers and we can multiply integers. So those are going to be our two operations, and those operations satisfy some rules. So this is going to give us our definition of a ring. So we'll study all structures that have two operations that satisfy some rules among these operations. We'll cover some basics about rings. So we'll talk about the definition. We'll do some examples. We'll talk about properties of rings. We'll talk about subrings. And then we'll talk about homomorphisms and isomorphisms. But afterwards, what we're going to do is we're going to study an important class of rings. Namely, we'll study what are called polynomial rings. So these are going to be collections of polynomials where the coefficients come from a field. So a field is a type of ring that behaves really nicely. So like we'll talk about what nicely means as well. But for example, like the rational numbers, the real numbers, the complex numbers, in some sense, you can always add, subtract, multiply, and divide as long as you're not dividing by zero, of course. So these are going to be examples of fields, a formal definition to come in a future video. But we'll see that the polynomial rings, the sets of polynomials, they have two operations. They have addition and multiplication. I could always add polynomials. I can always multiply polynomials. So I can do arithmetic there, but I'll see that they have a lot of properties in common with the integers. We'll see that, for example, there's a division algorithm. There's this notion of divisibility. I can take two polynomials and divide them. I can talk about unique factorization. I can also talk about congruence and do congruence class arithmetic. So something like modular arithmetic with polynomials. So we'll see that polynomials behave very, very nicely as well. Then we're going to want to probe rings a little bit deeper. We have these two examples of really nice rings, the integers and polynomial rings. We'll see that they have some nice behavior. So we will want to ask, well, what is it that's making these rings behave so well? And can I generalize congruence class arithmetic, so like modular arithmetic, to other rings, right? Is modular arithmetic something that's special to Z, or does it somehow generalize to other rings? So we'll get into some notions. We'll talk about ideals and quotient rings. So this is going to generalize our notion of congruence arithmetic in Z and congruence arithmetic in polynomial rings. And then we'll talk about some very, very special kinds of rings and their behaviors. We'll talk about what are called Euclidean domains. So these are rings where you have a division algorithm. We'll talk about principal ideal domains, and these will be a little bit more natural once we talk about ideals and we discuss the polynomial rings and the integers. We'll see that the polynomial rings and integers are examples of PIDs. And then we'll talk about what are called unique factorization domains, which we'll refer to as UFDs. What is a unique factorization domain? Unique factorization domain is anything where we have Any element that's not zero or what's going to be called a unit, so something like plus or minus one, can be factored into a product of what are called irreducibles. So irreducible is going to replace our notion of prime later on. And we'll see that every Euclidean domain, so every ring that has a division algorithm in some sense, is going to be a unique factorization domain. So in some sense, division algorithm implies the existence of unique factorization, but we'll also see that there are rings that are unique factorization domains that don't necessarily have a division algorithm. So again, we'll formalize what this all means. So this will kind of wrap up our study of rings. And then we'll move on to groups. And groups are actually structures that are simpler than rings. So groups are sets that have one operation defined on them, and that operation satisfies a simple set of rules. So for example, you could think of the integers under addition. That's an example of a group. You can think of the non-zero real numbers under multiplication. That's an example of a group. From linear algebra, if you take the 2x2 invertible matrices with real entries under matrix multiplication, that'll be an example of a group. And we'll talk about these examples later on. And then we'll talk about subgroups, homomorphisms and isomorphisms, normal subgroups, and quotient groups. So these will be notions that are kind of analogous to things that we found for rings. The reason I do groups second is because examples of groups are a bit stranger. They're a bit weirder. So there are going to be like symmetry groups and things like that that come up. So I kind of want to go through some notion of working with binary operations, following sets of rules before we get into, weirder operations. I want to kind of start with operations that might feel more natural. So groups, like I said, there are going to be some more broad examples, some more interesting examples. And then once we finish that, we'll talk about finite abelian groups, Celo theorems, and maybe some other topics. So that'll basically wrap up our course in abstract algebra.